Praise the Lord. Good morning. It's nice to see you this morning, and thank you for those of you who have chose to come and worship with us this morning for the first time. Thank you and for coming, and you are welcome again and again. It's nice to see you today. You know, we were with you last Sunday, and thank you for coming today. Hope you had a great week. It's interesting that you change time here, you know. So we had a long night. That was nice, but we never did that in Kenya, even at any time. Time, you don't tamper with it, so. That was nice. So today we are, you know, in our series on the book of Philippians, and we are almost halfway of it. And it's interesting how, you know, how the Lord is teaching us through the Sunday school class, and, you know, also through the letters of Paul, Romans, and now we are dealing with Philippians. And I don't know, as I told you, when we had the series on Greek Rio, the series on what he was going through, I don't know what the Lord is, you know, is doing in our midst, but one thing I'm sure of, that he is preparing us for something great. You know, he's preparing us for something, and I don't know what, but one thing is that he wants us to be more like him. And today we'll be dealing with two verses in chapter 2, from verses 12 to 13. Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 and 13. And Paul's telling the believers, "Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you to will and to act according to his good purpose." When I was growing up, and thank God I grew up in a church, you know, from the word go, and I did from, you know, from my young stage. And I used to hear this term now and then, that the Lord changed me. I don't know whether you have heard of that. You know what, brothers? The Lord has changed my life. And I didn't know how the Lord changes people, you know, you guys, how does the Lord change people? You know, we talk about you are saved. How does the Lord do that? Okay, does he do a surgery, like on a brain, and removes the, you know, your former things and brings something new? Or does he brainwash, you know, like, you know, just removing what, you know, your former life and giving you a new thing? Is that the change that he does? You know, there are confusing ideas on that. There are some who says that if you want to change, that if you really, you know you are in this bad habit and you know you're not walking with the Lord, if you really want to change, what you need to do is to just stay there, be in the Lord's presence, and let the Lord do that, change you. You know, don't do anything. We call those people passive. You know, don't do anything. Just surrender yourself there and the Lord will change you. Okay, there are others who say that if you don't want to change, if you really want to change, it's about me. So I'm going to really do this, try hard and do my best, because it's all about me to change. Those are the activists. You know, it's all about me, and the passive, you know, it's not about me, it's about the Lord. And the question is, who is on the right track? Is it all about me, or is it all about the Lord? And Paul deals with that in these two verses here. It's a combination. It is a combination. If I want to grow, if I really want to be more like Christ on my daily basis, it is all about me and it's all about him. It's all about him and it's all about me. It's me working with the Lord to change me. And that's what the topic today. It's God's part, my part in changing me. I love this, you know, this has been in me for the last 2 weeks, so it's just nice to me. It's about changing me, but for me to change, I need God, and Paul deals with that. He uses two phrases here. He says that continue to work out your salvation in fear and trembling, for it is God who works in, that's the second phrase. Work out, for it is God who works in you to will and to act according to his good purpose. So, work out and work in. Let's start with work out. And work out, that's your part. That's my part. Work out. And then the Lord has his way of working in us now. It's a combination. Ladies, my brothers and sisters, if we really want to grow and to be more like Christ on a daily basis, it has to be a combination of me and of the Lord so that we can be transformed to be more again. So work out. Notice here, and this is nice, it does not say work for. You know, it doesn't say work for, because it's already a done deal. We don't work for our salvation. We don't work towards salvation. It is a done deal on the Calvary when our Lord and Savior died. And Lord Paul talks about that when he said that while we were still dead in our sin, in Romans 5 verses 8. So we don't have, it's not about working for salvation. It's working out the implication of our salvation. I hope that gets it. It's working out. Now that we are believers, now that we believe in him, is to work out for that, is to develop what he has already started in our life. A good example is, you have seen, do you call them weightlifters?
Yes.
The guy who built the muscles?
Yes.
You see, they don't work for the body. You know, they don't work so that they can get the body. You see? They work out their body so that they can develop, you know, they work out, you know, so that they can develop their muscles. Another example is the farmers. And I had an experience, you know, you shared with me this morning about farmers. You know, when a farmer works the ground, he is cultivating it, not working for, you know, it is working out so that it is going to bring out crops. He's not working so that he can get the farm in all the ground. So it's working out the implication. That's what Paul is saying here. That work out for that. And the next thing is, he says that work out your salvation. You can circle the word your salvation. You know, he's talking about individual assignment. That's me as Joseph, to work out, not try to conform other people or try to imitate so and so. No, it's my individual, it's my personal responsibility to grow and to be more like Christ. As we try to do family devotion and you know and all that, whatever we try to do as a group and come to church and fellowship together, you know, it all narrows down to the individual, to you as a person. Am I willing to make this change? Am I willing to cooperate, you know, to work with God to change me? So is that individual assignment, you know? And then he talks about with fear and trembling. What I'm doing right now, I'm just working on that verse, just taking out pieces together. Put on pieces and bring them together. So he talks about with fear and trembling. And the question is, you know, should we be afraid of God? Is it what Paul is talking about? That we should, you know, we are afraid, you know, that we don't want to be there. But I don't think that's what Paul is talking about here. You know, is that you are afraid, or I am afraid, to miss out on what God has made for me. That's the fear that I'm seeing. Believers don't have to be to fear our God, you know, in that like we are far away from Him. No, because He is our daddy, He is our father. So we have that relationship with Him. But it is that fear of missing out what He has prepared for me, you know, for us. It's like an urge to encourage us to work, you know, to take our salvation more seriously. Be serious on your salvation. It's a great thing. Take it seriously. And then he talks about, for it is God who works now in you. And that's God's word. It is God now who works in you. It's God who energizes you, who gives you energy, who gives you the will and the ability to change. So you see the combination of that. You have your part, I have my part, and God has His part to energize us, to give us power and ability, the desire and the capability to change. Now, I want to present to you three tools that God uses to change us, and three choices that we can decide to take them or not to take them for us to change. So these tools are there, and the Lord has given them to us freely for me and you to change. But you and I have a choice to make. Am I willing to use that tool that God has given me? And the first tool, so that's the thing, the first tool that God uses to change us, He uses the Bible. These are things that we know, that we know, but sometimes we have not been taking it seriously. He uses the Bible, His word, His revealed word. And Paul talked about that when he told Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 3, 16 and 17. And he said, all scripture, not some, all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. That's the tool. It's God-breathed. It's inspired. It's God-breathed for us. And it's good to know the word all scripture, because there are some people nowadays who are saying that, you know, you don't need to read Old Testament. We are living in the New Testament, so you don't need to do that. What are you telling me? You know, taking the Old Testament or taking prophecy, you are just getting rid of a third of the revealed word of God. So it's the whole word. It's Genesis to Revelation. You know, yesterday I went to one of the seminars, learned through the book of Revelation. And it was interesting to see some of the church fathers who never believed in the book of Revelation. They never. And a good example, I'm not putting somebody down, but I bet they didn't have the whole pieces together. One was like Martin Luther, who said that he never saw Christ in Revelation. And you read Revelation and say, no, that's not right, because Christ is really seen there. You know, he's really there. So it's all scripture. It's all what God has revealed to us. It's God's word. And it is useful, you know, for teaching us. And you know, it's teaching us this morning, you know, to rebuke us when we go on the wrong, to tell us we are not on the right track, you know, to correct us, to train me and you in righteousness. And the reason for that is so that you and I may be equipped for every good work. That's the tool. And God has revealed to us, you know, and if we're going to change, We need to read it. And remember what we talked about the other time. We need to read it. We need to study it. We need to memorize it. We need to meditate it. You know, we need to live it in our daily life. And the more we get in the Word of God, which I want to encourage you to continue doing, and me, the more we get in the Word of God, you know, the more we read, we study it, and we not only just ahead knowledge, but, you know, to inform us and to instruct our heart. What it does, it influences our behavior towards godliness. So when we read it and then we let it instruct our heart, and then what comes out of that will be influenced towards living, you know, towards change. And the choice that you and I need to make, the tool is there, the Bible is there. Praise God, you have it with different versions, you know, with all the even the different good versions that are there today. And what the Word of God does, it changes our worldview. It changes our thinking. As we have seen Paul telling Timothy, that this word is going to correct you. This word is going to, you know, to rebuke you. This word is going to train you in righteousness. So what the word does when we read it, when we study it, is it changes our thinking. It changes our worldview. And the choice that you and I need to make is that I need to choose what to think about. That's the choice. If I really want to change, I need to think. I need to choose what to think about. Am I going to choose to think what the world is telling me, or continue with my worldview the way I have been going on in my life, or am I going to do things and think the way the world is telling me? That's the choice that we need to make. You know, when you read the word and it tells you, you know, correct this. You have been walking in pride. Correct that. You know, it's a choice for you to choose. Am I going to change this or not? And that's the question to me and to you. Am I going to choose? You know, is that to choose what to think about? You know, life is all narrowed down. You know, the things that we do in life, they all come from the way we think. And so when we saturate our mind with the word, what comes out of that, it's the word. It's that now living it in our daily life. When we saturate our mind with the things that are happening on this world, what gets out of there, it's that. You have not, you know this term in computer, whereby they say GIGO, G-I-G-O. Have you heard of that? G-I-G-O. That is garbage in, garbage out. It comes from the computer world, that whatever you put in the computer, whatever you say, is what you is going to give you. You know that. Whatever you save in your computer, that's why we love it. You know, whatever you save it, you know, you have all these assignments that you have to do, all songs, all poems, whatever you feed and you save there, when you come after 1 week, if somebody have not tampered with that, that's exactly what it's going to give you. So it's garbage in, garbage out. The same. Garbage in, garbage out. It's what we put in our mind. It's what's going to come out of our mind. And that's why we, you know, for our thinking to be really transformed, for our thinking to, you know, to really want to live for Christ, is for me and on you to garbage our mind with God's word. If I may use that. Yeah, that's a good garbage. But it's to put our mind, you know, it's to saturate our mind with good things, you know, with what the Bible says. And exactly that's what's going to come out. You know, I'm not talking about trying to read the whole Bible, you know, in 1 year. It's good if you are for that. But it's what you learn in the Word, it's what you study in the Word that you want to put it into practice. That what you mark, you know, people have made joke of that. That what you mark in the Bible, you know, what you mark, like when you are marking right now, what you mark in the Bible, that has marked you. You know, so somebody said that. That what you have marked in the Bible, that also that has marked you. It's in you and you are living. And that's a choice you need to make. I need to make. It's there. God has given us his tool. Am I willing to use it for me to be changed? And we have lots of examples in that. You know, you read of Psalm 1, verses 1 to 3. You know, blessed is the man who meditates on God's word. You know, when we meditate on God's word, it gets in our mind and it changes us. You know, Paul talks the same in the same chapter. This is in chapter 4, he talks of this and says, finally, brothers, in chapter 4, verse 8, he tells us, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. It's about our thinking, ladies and gentlemen. And this is a choice that we need to make. You know, Paul is admonishing this people. It's a choice to think those things that are praiseworthy, those things that are pure, is to work on our thinking. I know it's not easy, but it's a choice that we have to make. Somebody said this, you know, if we have a projector here, if somehow, I don't know how, but if somehow we were to screen what you are thinking on a projector and screen it on the wall, will you stand there and watch? You know, will you really stand there and watch what's going in our mind? I tell you, our mind you know what I'm about to say. But our mind has a tendency of just thinking, you know, things that are not right. But to make it think things that are pure, we're going to have to use the tool of saturating our mind with God's word. Praise the Lord. And Paul said, talked about that in Colossians also, 3:16, that let the word of God dwell in you richly, because he knew. When the word of God dwells in you richly, when you saturate your mind with that, what you are going to live is going to bring honor to God's name. And we have Psalms 119, and we have Joshua, who also talks about that. Now, the second tool that God has given us, and we have a choice to either use that or not, is the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit. You know, when you and I gave our life to Christ, we were sealed with the Holy Spirit. We have the Holy Spirit of God who is living in you and in me. He is there. He's the one who convicted you to give your life to Christ. John talks about that. He's the one who convicted you to give, you know, your life to him. And Romans 8 verse 11 says this. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who lives in you. That's a great confirmation to tell you that you have the Holy Spirit of God who is living in your life. I have the Holy Spirit of God who is living in my life. So, he is there. Paul also talks in 2 Corinthians 3:18. 2 Corinthians 3:18. And we, who with unrevealed faces all reflect the Lord's glory, are being transformed into his likeness with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Another proof that you have the Holy Spirit, who helps you, who transforms you, so that you can reflect him. You can reflect Jesus Christ. So, and the question that I want us to ask to ourselves, because the Holy Spirit is there, and he is living in your life, he is living in me. The question is, are we obeying the Holy Spirit who is living in us? You know, he prompts us. He prompts us. When we are about to do something, you know, but we know it's against God's will, he tells us, no, no, don't do it. He's there. And that's the question. Because that's God's agenda, is to transform us. And he has the Holy Spirit of God who is living in us. But the question is to us, do we make that choice? Because the choice that we need to make here is to depend on God's Spirit moment by moment. That's the choice that you and I have to make on a daily basis. That I will depend with the Holy Spirit of God on a daily basis, on our every time, to depend on him on a daily basis. And this power comes in him. You know, John gave a wonderful illustration about this in John 15, verses 4 and 5. John 15, verse 4 and 5. And he says this, that remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. A classic illustration to tell us that we need to depend on the Holy Spirit on a daily moment. We need to rely on him on a daily basis. Jesus is giving an illustration about, you know, a vine and its branches. And we all have fruits, different kinds of fruits. We have grapes and all that. If you go and remove a branch, you know, a branch from, you know, or a branch of, what do we have here?
Apples.
Apples. If you remove apple, you know, an apple branch from its stem, what's going to do? It's going to die. And just saying that, you know, the same, the branch and the vine has to be together so that branch can bear fruit. And the same, if you and I, we want to bear fruit, want to conform to the image of him who saved us, our Lord Jesus Christ, if we are to do that, we need to remain in him so that we are going to bear branch, to bear fruit, not to bear branches, to bear fruit. When we decide not to do that, we will not bear fruit. What we will do, we will start faking fruits. Now, imagine this. Imagine taking a dead branch and you go and you put it on the ground. It's a branch. You go and put it on the ground, and then you see that after 2 weeks or 3 weeks before the during the harvest time you have planted it, but during the harvesting time you go and probably it was an apple branch, and after when the harvesting time comes. You see, it's already dry, even when it's there. But at harvest time, you come with an apple and tie it around there. And then you call people telling them, you know what? I have produced, apples. You know, they will look at you and think, are you working well? are you all right? And the point is, bearing of fruits, it's an inside job. Bearing of fruits, brothers and sisters, it's an inside job. It is that me and you and the Holy Spirit working together, you and the Holy Spirit working together, obeying Him on a daily basis, and you will bear fruits. It will just flow by itself. You will not have to struggle or try to fix something. It will come because you are working with Him. And that's what I see with Jesus. It's the branch and the vine working together to produce fruit. It's me and you working with our Lord Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit of God who He has poured on us to bear fruits. It's an inside-out job, not the other way around. And now you're asking, how do I depend with the Holy Spirit, on a moment by moment? I know it's nice stuff, but how do I do that? It's checking on your prayer life. It's about your prayer life. Involving Him in all your activities, in all that you are doing, in the work that you are doing. It's inviting Him there. It's not trying to compact, I don't know what I'm going to pronounce that, to compact. To compartment life, whereby you say that today is Sunday, you're going to live for Christ today. Tomorrow is Monday, it's about the world. It's about now, and Christ is not there. Trying to separate life, and Christ is not seen in your life. But it's that depending on Him on a daily basis that, Lord, in my work, I'm doing this to glorify Your name. As I drive to work today, Lord, I'm doing this to honor Your name. So what I do, I'll do it, I will do it so that You'll be honored. In every activities that in all that we are doing, is that whispering of prayers to Him. Lord, I need Your guidance in this. I need Your guidance in this decision. The tendency with us, the way we usually do, we don't involve God when things are going okay. But when things go wrong, Lord, now intervene in this situation. But I want to urge you is to involve the Lord in all our activities. And Paul said, whether you eat, in 1 Corinthians 10:31, whether you eat or you drink, whatever you do, do it all for His glory. So it's in every activity that we do that we want to glorify Your name. So God uses the Bible, His word, to change us, and we have the choice that we need to make of thinking, to change our thinking to conform to what God tells us to do. And then the Holy Spirit and you and I need to make that choice of depending on Him on a daily basis, on moment by moment. Now, the third one that He uses, and I think I'm really not dogmatic on this, but I think He uses this because we are not willing to obey the first and the second. And I think the Lord is sometimes, okay, let me use this. I'm not dogmatic about that. You can disagree on that. But I think the Lord uses circumstances. Circumstances. You know, problems, pressures of life, headache, difficulties, sometimes stress of life. Difficult times. And sometimes he uses that to change us. And Paul knew about that, and he said in Romans, one of our favorite verses that we love, Romans 8, 28 and 29, he says that, and we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. Circumstances, those things that come in our life and we wish they would have come in our life. But the good thing is that as believers, as Christians, we know that all that comes in our life is not that the Lord is not concerned with us, but God is making it to work for good. It's to work for good. He has a purpose. He has a reason behind the struggles, behind the difficulties that we are going through. And this is to encourage you and me. You know, when we go through hard times, when we go through difficult moments, the Lord has not forgotten you. He still loves you the same. He is in that. But sometimes I think he is doing that, you know, to conform you to his likeness. You know, the question that we tend to ask is, where is this problem coming from? You know, that's the tendency. Where is this problem coming? Did I cause it? Did the devil cause it? You know, who did that? But I want to tell you this morning, and please get this. It really doesn't matter where the problem comes from. And it should not matter because no matter what the source, no matter what the source of the problem you are going through, God can use it in your life for his glory.
Amen.
And I have seen God doing that in the lives of people. God using that problem for his glory. So instead of concentrating on, oh, probably, especially in Africa, we tend to do that. That if your son or daughter is struggling with something, you tend to do, oh, it's because of the grandmother said this. You know, we try to associate that with the family problems. So instead of going to that mess, it's, you know, okay, Lord, you have allowed me to go through this, but I want to go into that and wait. I don't know what you are making, but one thing I know, you are making it to glorify your name. And all things fit and can fit together in a pattern, you know, for God's glory. You know, if God is going to make me to be more like Jesus, to be like Christ, he's going to put me and he's going to put you through situation that Jesus went through. That's the purpose. You know, if he's going to make me to be more like Christ, he's going to press me and you in things that Jesus Christ through. Now, let's take some of them. You know, was Jesus lonely? Was he sometimes lonely? Sometimes you'll be lonely. You know, was Jesus tempted? Ladies and gentlemen, you will be tempted. The only difference is that Jesus did not sin. You know, and the sin is not a must for us to sin when we are tempted. There's nothing wrong to be tempted. But how do we respond to that? You know, sometimes Jesus was depressed. Sometimes he got angry. Sometimes he was, like, impatient. You know, these are things that will be tempted in our life, that they are going to go through in our life. But the question that we need to ask ourselves in these circumstances, what's the lesson? You know, what's the lesson behind this? The choice that you and I need to make is that you and I need to choose how to respond to circumstances. I can choose my response to circumstances. How am I going to respond to that, you know? How am I going to respond to, you know, I have the word and in this circumstance, how am I going to respond to it? And James got it. James nailed it when he said it in James 1 verses 2 and 4. That consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds. Because, wow, let's throw down there. James is telling these believers who in that time they were going through persecution from the empires during that time. And he's saying that whenever you go through trials of many kinds, those difficult moments, you know, in your life, whenever you go through that, count it pure joy. And this is the reason why you should count it pure joy. Why you and I need to count it pure joy when we go through that. Because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be a mature and complete, not lacking anything. That's my response. That, Lord, this is not easy. Whatever I'm going through right now, it's not easy. But Lord, I know you are, my faith is being tested. And I know that you are developing perseverance in me. And I'm going to accept that. Because after perseverance has finished its work, I will stand out a mature person who is not lacking anything. And I want to encourage you this morning. I know as we are all seated here, and I know some who will be listening to this on YouTube, as we go through hard times in life, as we go through difficult moments, we have all those questions. Why? And instead of that, Lord, these trials that I'm going through, what you are doing, what they are doing in my life, they are developing my perseverance, making me to be a mature person. That need to encourage you this morning. That need to keep you going. You know, in that job, in whatever you are doing, struggling financially, you don't have work today, you know, things are not working out for you, you know, as they ought to do. Instead of those why questions, Lord, these circumstances, I know you are going to work and you have a pattern behind this. You are going to make it all to work together for your own glory. And also for me, you are developing perseverance in me. A great verse that was led to our Sunday school class this morning, to our children ministry this morning. And I want to close with that. Romans 5, 3 and 4. And it says that we can be full of joy here and now, even in our trials and troubles. These very things, that is trial and troubles, will give us patient endurance. This in turn will develop a mature character. That's what the Lord is doing. He's in the business of conforming us, of transforming us to the image of His Son, Jesus Christ. Let's be encouraged. As we go home today, in our trials, in our difficult moments, when things are not working out for us, let's be encouraged that the Lord is developing perseverance in our life. He is conforming us to the image of His Son, Jesus Christ. And I don't know why the Lord, He does that. He does that. Just look at the fruit of the Holy Spirit. What's taught in Galatians 6. you know, the, all the fruit of the Holy Spirit, for, you know, for them to, for you to be tested and to prove that these fruits are in you. You know, what the Lord does, He puts you in the exact opposite side of that. What I mean is that if He wants to know that, you know, we know that you love people, you know, we are told, you know, love, you know, that's one of the fruit there. You know, it's not hard to love the people that you go along with, isn't it? It is not hard to do that. But for that to be really tested, whether you really love people, you'll be put in the exact opposite. You know, in people who are really difficult to love, and you are afraid to show love to them. So the Lord is developing those good characters in our life. So God, He has revealed His will to us through His word. We have the Holy Spirit of God who is living in us. Are we willing to obey Him moment by moment? And when the circumstances, those difficult times come, how are you going to choose to respond to them? Respond positively, knowing that the Lord is developing something, a mature character in you, developing perseverance in your life. And that can keep you going and going and going. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for your word this morning. We thank you for Philippians, and thank you for Paul exhorting the Philippians to work out their salvation, because you are the one who is working in them. And this is the encouragement for us this morning. Thank you for the tools that you give. And we pray that, Lord, we will be willing to do our part to respond positively to those difficult moments in our life, to study your word and to saturate your mind, our mind, with your word, and to depend with your Holy Spirit on a daily basis. We pray that you help us throughout this week and throughout this month. The Lord will reflect your character in our life. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.